So please pardon us. I hope you enjoyed your tea break. I spoke to lunch. So it's still lunch. Oh, it's still break. Quiet presence. Don't be afraid. Yeah, that's it. Okay, we want to just go to the next module, looking at bio risk, capitalization, and evaluation. Of course, like Adela said, for many of us, I'm sure we are going through this module. Having been to just flip through it. So we're going to be as fast as possible. Bio risk characterization and evaluation. No need for introduction. Now, cost overview. The major things we are supposed to go on with. Talk about basics of risk assessment. Of course, after the consultative regulation, to have basics of risk assessment, look at risk characterization and the evaluation. The key messages. That the risk assessment supports understanding risks based upon activities and also aids risk decision making. That's the first key message. Second one is that risk characterization is the process of identifying the factors that contribute to risk, then determining the likelihood and consequences that contribute to risk. Then we look at risk evaluation, which is the process of determining whether a particular risk is acceptable or not acceptable to a facility or an institution. So those are three major key messages. This is still us already talking about the AMP model when we're looking at bio-risk management. So look at the components again. We're dwelling more on bio-risk assessment here. And then later we'll talk a little mitigation performance. So basics of risk assessment. Intended to offer a more complete understanding of the risk evaluation and evaluation process. Now, biological risk assessment is actually divided into two. We have the biosafety risk assessment, the biosecurity risk assessment. I'm sure when we're talking about biosafety and biosecurity, we actually cover, I think, ahead of us make some inputs on that. Okay. This one is designed to actually characterize safety risks in the laboratory. And I know we actually mentioned, can we remind ourselves of safety risk?
Spillage.
Infection. Okay. Spillage. Little break, sleeps, tips and all that. Now look at the biosecurity risk assessment that actually has to do with how to characterize risks, biosecurity risk in the laboratory. Now we remind ourselves of some of those security risks. Okay. Patient access control.
Security guards.
Security guards.
Fences now. Locks and
are they actually are they the security risk?
No,
mitigation. Mitigation measures. All right.
Security risk is the bad guy.
Yeah. The church is not a
loss. Okay. Unauthorized access. Yeah, because if we're looking at, you know, fire security risk assessment here, of course, we're looking at our focus is actually on what the threat, right?
Yes.
Intentional, exactly. Okay. Why do we need to perform a biological risk assessment? Okay, so performing a biological risk assessment here is like trying to throw up questions, which we now, based on the questions, we begin to now proffer answers and solutions. Okay. Okay. What is risk? We're not doing it in groups now. I think we just look at what risk is in general. Yeah, risk.
Yes.
Potential harm. Okay, potential harm. Or threat. Okay, who agrees with that?
Well, I want to complete things that will result in a bad outcome or unexpected outcome.
The potential harm that will result.
Into unexpected.
Okay. All right. Risk is the likelihood of an undesirable event happening that involves a specific hazard or threat and has consequences. Now, in this definition, it has covered, you know, hazard that has to do with biosafety. Has also covered threat that has to do with biosecurity. You are saying in either of the cases, they have potential, you know, consequences. Are we together?
Yes.
Then we also told again that risk is actually a function of likelihood and consequences. So what is the risk of being attacked by a tiger? We not also list these examples, but let's just go straight to what they ask us to do. Okay, if we just go back a little, what is the risk of being attacked by a tiger? It's like an open question. Right?
Yes.
No, we're just saying, okay, you can imagine the scenario. You know, the scenario.
No, we're.
What the reason of most being attacked by that idea? Yeah. I will tell you.
Okay, okay. Let us make your scenario here.
No, it really cannot. It can't be zero. Why do I say it can't be zero?
Don't seem to know the value.
No. Whether your next door neighbor has fiber as a pet, you don't know.
There's no assessment.
So there is no like you cannot question. But if you understand from the point of view of saying what is the risk is if the tiger is free to move about. Yes, if the tiger is the risk is if the tiger is free to move about, or if the tiger is a grown tiger and is also hungry, all these things are risks.
Just the likelihood of the tiger being a permanent investment. What's likely of the tiger being here? As far as Nigeria is concerned, the tiger is here. But how do we know that we assess by looking at the state government if anybody has a license back to the building? Don't forget that because if there's a license, a tiger living two houses away from you, the likelihood has already been reduced. Because you
think
the best to
play
assessment
for. Yeah, I like the fact that everybody is saying we need to tie the risk of being attacked by tiger to a particular condition. Maybe an open field, maybe in the forest, in the zoo, and all that. I know for some of us that have gone through this model before, this model before, you know, we got to, you know, looking at some various aspects of possible exposure. But here, we're not looking at now what is the risk of being attacked by a tiger and all the civilian equipment here are telling, okay, for instance, okay, here we are not aware that if there's tiger anywhere, so the risk of being attacked by a tiger is very, very low. I like that. Okay. If we agree on that, then we now look at the concept of likelihood and consequences, and then try to rate them according to very high, moderate, low, or very low. Do not forget that at this stage, we're trying to do your assessment, right?
Yes.
Okay. These are some scenarios that they are showing us. That you are in an open field next to a very hungry, aggressive adult tiger. The tiger is unrestrained and sees you as a food.
The likelihood is high, the consequences is fatal.
This is very high.
Yeah.
The likelihood and consequences are high. Okay. Now, in the second one, you are in a zoo observing a cage adult tiger, which is well fed and has a mild temperament.
The likelihood is low. Most low. Likelihood is low. Consequences is high.
Yeah. Consequences is low.
Consequences is high always. Consequences is constant. But the likelihood of it happening is low because the guy is well fed, he's also mild, and is of a mild temperament. So the likelihood is low. The consequences remain fatal. An attack is a tiger.
Attack is a tiger.
Yes.
It's plausible. The likelihood is low.
Adult tiger.
Yes, please.
Okay.
Yeah.
So have
the consequences.
All right. You are holding a tiger cub with a playful temperament in your hands.
Yes, consequences is low. Likelihood is high.
Okay.
Yes. Oh, absolutely.
So likelihood
consequences.
You are at the zoo observing a mellow tiger cub located behind a strong glass window.
No likelihood, no consequence.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, I like this. I like this
scenario.
This scenario, and many times when I have had the opportunity of taking this very module, I try to bring those to laboratory condition scenario. Now, for those of us who work in TB lab. TB laboratory, the culture lab. Now, the first scenario, as if you're working in a TB lab, a TB lab, very good culture. Are you following? What is the likelihood of being infected? And the consequence?
The scenario. If you are working with MTB or MGR or SDR,
let's take SDR.
And now you are not even using containment, or you are using a low level containment.
That's
the likelihood and the consequences.
Yeah, that's why I didn't want to talk about containment. I just said you are working with such high profile organism without any containment.
On your own.
So the consequence is high. The likelihood is also high.
Okay.
Excuse me. I like that. All right. Thank you very much.
So
that's exactly what I had to bring out here. That you have in such a lab where you are cultivating SDR, and then the risk, the consequence high, likelihood high. Now, if you are cultivating the same MTV and you have well certified hopefully, well-certified BSL with all the operational facilities fully running. Hopefully now, what is the likelihood?
Likelihood is low.
Consequence?
High.
Consequence?
Very high.
Hopefully now,
yes.
We're trying to bring them from this issue of either, then bring it to the laboratory setting and green light. So the consequence to be high, likelihood low. Now, assuming you are working in the same laboratory, and then you have okay, so because we're looking at so you have a kind of strain of TB. Maybe okay, I mentioned TB. I'm gonna just microbacterium. Perhaps not the one that is as prevalent as the MTB. So you have another maybe, yeah. Okay, but I'm looking at, you know, he began to talk about the type of MTB, whether it is XDR or iPhone or MDR. Now you are trying to update them, you know, according to the level of virulence, right? So the same, assuming we have, you know, a strain that is less prevalent, or we look at is a species. Even if, of course, there are some, you know, species that are not going to be
infecting human.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So assuming someone is working with that, I follow you.
Yeah.
So we are trying to graduate it and then put it on the same scale. Like we have an adult lion, we have a cub. So that's bringing it down to the laboratory, the scenarios that we have. Yes, yes.
For instance, there are communities that don't have good drinking water. They depend on sheep, depend on others for water. So what consequences are there? We should also try to bring in areas like that. Not just center into laboratory work. That's the area I want to bring it to. So what is the problem? We also need to look at the consequences of such things. As if community can work into a stream that is polluted.
Of course, everything boils down to assessment.
Yeah.
Everything boils down to assessment. So we must assess, and then before, so we assess.
Look at
you know, the violence possibility of getting infected. We have to look at, you know, that's why we're talking about risk, consequences, and then likelihood. Yes, ma'am.
The government is now giving cholera stage. Okay. In addition, they are extending the treatment to keep to hygiene, more open
medication
and so all this have been put in place. So what a common living can now do?
Exactly. That's right. Yeah. So you know the assessment in over end. The assessment. Okay.
Just to pass.
Okay.
What can you help people to think of this? That assessment information is very key. For assessment, if you need the valuable information to lead you to a job assessment and motivation to be involved. So, getting our data and information to be able to come up with proper assessment is very, very important.
Very, very important. Okay. Sorry, let me just go straight to. Of course, you know, we've been talking about the objective here. You said that risk assessment will support the selection of appropriate mitigation measures. Okay, whether for biosafety or biosecurity. Now let's come to this slide. This is actually the slide that the team approved that we should dwell on for some time. Now this is a call it like a flow diagram of what this risk characterization and evaluation actually look like. Now at the top there, we're looking at say describe work activities and then identify hazards and identify any threats. Describe work activities. Now, this describe what activities here. It's where you're not trying to have some input information. For example, if I need to describe the work activity, maybe I do, maybe we'll do ALB study. Two samples. Are you following now?
Yeah.
Okay, so in this assessment, because this is where you must start before you can now evaluate and now proper mitigation measures. So the intention here is that we should look at the process of carrying out ZN stain to actually doing the microscopy. So every bit of the work, when the sample, how the sample is received, how it gets into the lab, how, you know, the slides are properly washed, the process of handling the slide, how do you transfer, how do you open the container, how do you transfer the sputum, you know, to the slide, under what condition, then how do you eventually, you know, exactly, go off to staining. What are the processes? What kind of stain do you use? What's the type of stain, possibility of, you know, and nature of the stain? Are they carcinogenic? Are they toxic? And all that. I follow you.
Yeah.
So every bit of it is what you're looking at, describing work activities. Until when the slides are examined, and then when the slides are also discarded, you know, and disposed. I fully know. So it's a whole process, and it is in that process of looking at all the work activities that we can now know what we are supposed to do at every stage. Okay, I'm bringing this sample here. Under what condition will I begin to prepare the smear? Is it under fire safety cabinet? Is it outside? Then what kind of stain? Is this one poisonous? What should I do? That's the describing what the work activities. So take every bit of it and then describe. So it is in describing that we can now identify, you know, issues of hazards, and then also identify any threats. Just to give that one as a example. Are we together? So, in the scenario I just mentioned, if we're looking at that kind of work activity using sputum, what are we trying to identify in the possible hazard? Positive aging. So we're looking like biological hazard, right? From a safety perspective. Okay. So if we're also trying to assess in terms of my security, so we also need to look at the nature of the organism, right?
Yeah.
And then the possibility of threats.
Potential value.
Airborne here, that means we are talking about, okay, we are taking both my safety. Okay. That's very safety. Accessibility. Thank you very much. So at least we've come to that, identifying hazards and then any threat, right? Now the next one is now we determine the risk.
What
we talk about? Likely and consequences. I follow you now. So from our processes and what we have done, we should be able to now know what kind of agents we're actually working with, and then what are the possible risk of working with that agent, assuming I'm exposed, I follow you. Exactly. So what's the consequence? That's what we're trying to determine the risk involved. Now, after determining the risk, yes. Okay.
How do we make our classroom the type of people
And you talk about TV, you talk about other ones. You're supposed to be TV, too. There's also a
We just use TB as a sharing. Of course, the COVID, whether coronavirus or Lassa virus or Ebola virus and all that, they are all something, you know, what we can use. We can come under, you know, either Olympic age, that's all. The general flow is the same thing. Yeah, you can apply to the various specific conditions. Okay. So we now decide whether or not the risk is acceptable. Someone was talking about, you know, having done a lot about cholera, right? Now, let me just say, in terms of assessment, the assessment is not a one-off thing. For instance, assuming you are the director of a laboratory, you are the laboratory director in your institution, and now maybe FHI now visited the facility. Now say, okay, we are trying to support your facility, and then we want to start a new program. They want to start a TV program. Sorry, I use a TV, but if you're going to come up. So, they want to start a TV lab. I'm talking about a full TV lab now, culture and all that. Now, the director says, oh, okay, this is your idea, it's beautiful. All together. Now, you give us some time. So this gives us some time. We'll enable the director and his team to now do an assessment of that is our very facility. And then to consider whether they have the required necessary things to do for that program to commence. Are we together?
Yes.
So one of the things the director we need to look at. I don't know, maybe somebody has an example. That's a big program. One thing that you should be
is space.
So you look at you know, space, you like facility layout, right? Okay?
The staff.
So you need, you know, capacity. Okay?
Equipment.
All right. Practice some procedures in that environment. All this were here. You know, after you look at all this and make a solution, you now decide whether or not, because you also look at this lab or this program you are bringing to us, and what is the risk level in terms of exposure for working with this organism? Do we have ready immunization? I follow you. In the case of an exposure, can we have, you know, rapid response and all that? That's part of what will inform the decision of the director. So now say, okay, well, from what we have assessed, we have the capacity to commence this program. Or we do not have the capacity to commence this program. Are we together?
Yes.
So, the feedback to everything, I mean, thank you very much for your concern and then your interest here. But we do not have the capacity to initiate this program. Or they have some measure of capacity, but they need to beef up what they have. All together to say, decide whether or not risk is acceptable. So, if the decision is yes, say proceed with work and then monitor controls. So, this proceed with work will be we have all that it takes, we have the qualified personnel, we have materials, we have good layout, and all that, and then we can now start and this program. But they say, if it is not, we can prepare risk control action plan when a prof will come and take mitigation, and then we'll talk more about that. But seeing what happens during, you know, assessment. Now, at this level of deciding whether or not the risk is accepted, this is where we actually come to, you know, evaluation.
All the time.
We're just talking about what are the agents
we're working with.
What are the conditions? Is there any risk at all?
If there is risk.
Are you following? What are the consequences? Will it be higher? What is the likely exposure? All those also are coming under the assessment. Now, in terms of the evaluation, so we're looking at deciding. So we weigh all that we have assessed, and then come to take, make a decision on what we need to do. I follow you now. All right. Now, in the aspect of that decision, to make a decision, that's now evaluation. I'm sorry, many of the other aspects that we are discussing here are things that follow, you know, down the module. There is this aspect that, you know, whether an organization is risk tolerant or risk averse. It's also at the point of this decision making. Okay. The risk level that we have identified here is too high.
And because of this,
we may not be able to start this project. Another observer can say, okay, considering the risk and relatively, I think we can, you know, commence something. And
we're not saying that
there are some observations that they are, you know, they are risk averse. In other words, everything that they identify as a risk, they will love to either suspend and say we cannot handle this project.
Even when the likelihood is low.
You say, no, the likelihood is low, we understand, but we do not want to go into this project. All these things, they come under, you know, why the organization will make the decision either to carry on or not. But here, after considering all these things, I let's say that this risk is not acceptable to us. That's after the assessment and then the evaluation now. So if not, you can go ahead and then to prepare some risk control action plan. That's where mitigation comes in. This mitigation is, you know, it is called plan. The plan now is that you already thoughtfully thinking ahead of what can be done to handle the risk, even when you have not started putting it in place, but you've been thoughtful in terms of plan. Now, the other aspect of the no is that say you revise or you close the project. Are you following now?
Yeah,
there was this cellulose sulfide gel project. You remember when that was in the HIV era? I think UPT was one of the centers where they were doing recruitment for, you know, call them commercial sex workers and all that, that they can be exposed to HIV, you know, partners. in applying the solo sulfur gel, and then with, plus it was a trial, like a clinical trial. And then the, where it was expected that those exposed will not be infected. Are we together? And so there are people that actually came and signed into the project. The project was on in our department. They took you to Okeko Street. You remember? Yeah, so over time, it was now being observed that there were girls who signed into the project, even if they were given a fee. But along the line, they were tested positive. I follow now. Testing positive, the project was eventually reassessed, and then the project had to be closed because of you know, consequences. That's an example I want to draw. So we have there, we prepare risk control action plan and then implement the control measures. That's mitigation. And then, as we continue, we can now review the adequacy of the plan. This is what? Performance. So, if we review the adequacy of the plan, if it is not going on well, we can also decide again or not whether or not what we have reassessed, whether it is working well for us. And then the cycle continues. Are we together?
Yes, sir.
So in a nutshell, that's what we are talking about in terms of risk characterization and evaluation. So we do risk assessment, we try to identify the agent, the hazard or the threat. And then we look at what will be the risk of exposure. Is it high, the likelihood? Is it high? Is it low? If there is likelihood of getting exposed to that, what will be the consequence? The consequence is going to be high. Is it low? So we take all those as assessment. And having done the assessment, we now come to, to make a decision as to what we have identified. The risk is very low because either the consequence is low, the likelihood is low. And depending on what we have eventually evaluated, we now make a decision and say our organization is risk averse. Even if the consequence is low or the likelihood is even low, we do not want to go into this project. Some can say, even if the consequence is high, I say, but we know that the likelihood of exposure is low. I say, we are going into the project. So those kind of organizations can be referred to as risk tolerant. The other one referred to as risk averse. Now, depending on whatever informed your decision. And so at the end, you can now, so if you decide to go into the project, to start that, decide the project, after a given time, you have to go, you have to do a reassessment, review the adequacy of your mitigation measures, if your plan it is working. And then, like my friend said, yeah, Dan, he said that you need a lot of data. So depending on what you are getting as feedback, that will not help you to know whether our plans are working as we are actually put in place. And so the cycle goes on. I think with this, I've been able to explain. So that's risk calculation.
Remember that today it was the issue of consequences that caused problems.
Okay.
Remember, I called the problem okay. You know the basic picture is now I got that broke out and I was new to set up a reference lab. And they said they're going to try to take it. So the people of today, they remote them. I said, why is it that every party is what you want to do? I keep asking me to give you up with this reason. That's the one of being a follower. That's how they didn't start to live there. They don't want to say, I need to be part of it. Sorry?
Exactly.
Yes. All right, so let's look at so you have this is the risk aversion, like you said, you know, describing performance activities, identify hazards, identify defects, determine risk. So look at this evaluation. That was risk evaluation. So we have decided whether or not risk is acceptable.
And if yes, we proceed with what the weather controls as risk evaluation. So all this put together is what we are telling and trying as risk evaluation. All right. We have already, you know, talked about all this, and then I will end here, unless there is any question that you need to ask. He practically talked about what we have to say here. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir.
Yes, I did very well.
I just want to ask what is the right from what you said? Exactly what I'm saying. What is the brain part? Therefore, this and the coming back of that. It's one of the things that make sure I'm getting something from the brain. On the other hand, we're going to get a kind of problem. So, the assumption is that this is not a good thing. Was approved in the language. So it would have been breaches in all the protocols that are trying to come out of the consequences are much also a chance to have given for the resources. So try to put that in context of what have been trying to bring back. The import of what has been is extremely important to the fire. As we say, about this different type of things. Because the British are trying to go back to China. It's in the lower. That's the one I said, because they truly are going to be there. There's evidence that in China they are saying that one or two persons are there. That's what I'm going to do. China is living in America. And here is a hot one. People who died the year previously from one powerful vaccine. Actually, they had a population. And they so, in the back of the country, they call it the population. And they
don't even know
something. So, there's a danger. Yeah, well, what we are doing is that is a really to talk about. You make this one in your face. Makes it real.
Mm-hmm. And just to add to what you're saying, the conference is when you, by the time we're doing that insecurity, it will open our eyes more to begin to think deeply about COVID. It's more of a biosecurity issue. Yeah. Intentional release by World Health, whatever they want to identify, conspiracy theories we're hearing about that. So it's tilting towards more to biosecurity than biosafety. For this COVID issue, there are political networks that they have brought us where we are. We don't have all the,
What is the end? They want the motion. Because behind every behavior of the motion.
Of course, global powers. Then you don't know. You don't know what, that is control. Global power control is power. Okay. At that level. Yes.
It's a result of war.
That's a. Okay, so.
Okay, so for us.
Mitigation.
For us. what you know, as the pandemic, you know, began, on hearing of the coronavirus, you know, SARS-CoV-2 as eventually named. Of course, from that beginning, nobody actually could place the nature of the agent. There was need to actually study more by the agent before we are not able to actually characterize and put the agent into the group he actually should belong. And that's the area that concerns us most. How do we, you know, characterize agents? And then having characterized, how do we put that in perspective of the risk involved? And then we now begin to look at mitigation measures. Whether we're looking at it as a hazard, as a biohazard lab, or we're looking at it as a bio threat in terms of biosecurity. Thank you very much.
It is better to receive applause when you finish a presentation than to be booed, or than for people to just keep quiet. I was going to add, but I didn't want to break his flow, that in the case of COVID-19, depending on where you are looking at it, you will look at biosecurity. But when you look at laboratory environment, we are working on the COVID samples and so on, with respect to the lab personnel, we'll be looking at biosensors. And that is what makes this training very, very relevant to what we've done. And what we are actually not actively doing, but possibly we are part of it. So thank you very much. I do not have much to do because we have done most of the work. In the risk assessment strategy that the facilitator took us through, we saw aspects of risk characterization and evaluation. We saw mitigation and we saw performance. So what I just want to do is to put in perspective what we want to focus our mind on in terms of mitigation, and then we do same for performance. These are the key messages concerning mitigation. And I want us to also address our mind to the fact that biorisk management is stood on three major things. One is assessment, the other one is mitigation, and the third one. So this one, mitigation, if this leg out of those three is not put into consideration, then you are not standing on a balance. Thank you. So it's better for you to actually kneel down or stoop than for you to stand up two instead of three legs. We want us to take note that one key message is that we must understand the value of effective mitigation and its role in the AMP model. And then mitigation is most effective when it is based on thorough risk assessment. In risk assessment, apart from risk averse or risk tolerance, we talk about the robustness, of the risk assessment. If the risk assessment is not robust, it's not likely to take into account all the various factors that are supposed to be accounted for when you are planning the work. What that kind of thing leads to is that when you get to the middle, you get stopped, because that is when the real issue concerning that part of the world stares you in the face, and then you are able to take a decision. Why? If you want to take a decision to stop, you say you have already used so much materials and time. Meanwhile, if you want to go forward and say, let me continue, you are running a big risk that is bigger than if you had not started the work already. So that is why it is good for us to bear in mind that mitigation is most effective when it is based on the total risk assessment. And that there are five generally recognized categories of risk of mitigation measures. These are some of the ones we will go through now. Because each of them have their various advantages and disadvantages. Then take note of this other two, which says the risk is most effectively reduced through elimination or substitution, followed by engineering controls, and then administrative controls, as well as practices and procedures. And the list is PPE. I'll ask the question, why is PPE the least? I don't want an answer now. Just take the question. Okay, thank you. We will just go through these ones. These are just exercises to help us further understand about mitigation. So I want to go straight to the midst to the mitigation control measures. One is elimination or substitution. In your risk characterization, you have, for example, identified that you cannot be able to use a particular method or a particular equipment. Is it possible for you to forget about using that method if you have an alternative method? Are you with me?
Yeah.
If you have an alternative method, then substitute the one you have initially planned to use. That is what we are talking about, substitution. Are you with me?
Yeah.
In terms of elimination, if you don't have alternative, and it is a risk adverse situation, then you need to forget about the work. Eliminate it completely. The next one is about engineering controls. Engineering controls is talking about what are the equipment available for you to use as mitigation. Now, I'm sure we are very conversant with the fact that mitigation is not out for you to kill the project. It is out for you, where possible, minimize the risk. Or if possible, remove the risk completely, not the project. It is when you are in a no choice situation that you might have to close down the project completely. And Dr. Easter alluded a lot to that. So engineering controls, therefore, is talking about the use of facility design using engineering considerations. For example, you are going to set up a lab. You are going to ventilate the lab. What is the direction of wind flow? Where you are ventilating the lab into, what is the situation around the place? Are you with me? By engineering design, you can minimize the risk that the environment faces. Okay? Another thing about engineering control is if you are working in the laboratory and you are using a biosafety cabinet, how functional is your proper safety cabinet? Are you with me? How functional is it? I hope we don't have some people here who will get to the BSC and will not first test the direction of that flow. Are you with me? Okay. When last was it certified? Are you with me? So if for instance, we have a scenario that we cannot have time to go through, which we should say that the BSC cabinet has not been certified for 3 years. Oh, you see, you explained. In engineering control, what we are talking about is if the BSC is not functional, then you need to replace it. If it has not been certified, then you need to take it through the certification process. Again, another important factor, if it is not properly situated within the lab, it needs to be properly situated. Are you with me? These are all factors to consider in engineering controls. Administrative controls. In terms of the administrative controls, this is about facility policy. It's an establishment thing. It is about how the management of the facility brings up administrative principles and considerations in order to make the system run the way it is designed. For example, it is an administrative control to say that the personnel in the facility needs to go on periodic training, maybe once in every 6 months. It is not the laboratory quality manager. Even if he does, the management can tell you that they don't have the resources to do it. But if the management themselves makes it a policy, then it becomes an offense for the laboratory manager not to recommend his staff to go for training as at went to. Are you with me?
Yes.
So administrative controls, very, very important. But you know, management also has its own problems. The first problem of most management is you can go for that thing, but there's no cash backing. If there's no cash backing, how then can it be done? Okay. Another thing that comes under administrative control. For example, we just talked about engineering controls. But who is going to be responsible for the release of the funds to put the BSC, for example, to the normal condition that it's supposed to be? Or purchase a new one? There's a problem there. But I don't want us to go deep into the problem. Practices and procedures is talking about SOPs. Do we have a SOPs that addresses the particular work that we are talking about? For every laboratory activity, there should be an SOP. I have been a victim of SOP before. That's the one I'm talking about. We did this several times. We are controlling mosquito species in the lab. And everybody will think that, oh, okay, you have mosquito species responsible for yellow fever. That's the Aedes aegypti. You have the one responsible for malaria. That is Anopheles gambiae, and so on. And so you can take them through the same process and you get a good culture in the lab. It's a big lab. So we assume that, okay, we can culture this aegypti in the laboratory just like Anopheles gambiae, but it wasn't possible. Until we went through, and I actually had to lay down a step-by-step approach that if any of the steps was missing, and that is about SOP. For example, after we followed the SOP, we were able to force the mosquitoes to lay their eggs on moist filter paper. So we're able to collect the eggs and store them until we are able to produce mosquitoes. While we did not follow those procedures, we were not able to get the control. That is just as simple as it can sound in our land. So practices and procedures is talking about adherence to SOPs. In the risk assessment strategy, Once you identify that this is the work you want to do for every aspect of the world, let that be an SOP written and made available in the laboratory. If it is written and it's not available, of what use is it? Are you with me? You might not be the one that will be the lab to carry out the work. So how will they be able to follow the same process and get the result? Personal protective equipment is about PPEs. You know, COVID-19 has suddenly taught everybody about PPE. Are you with me? Such that somebody was telling me how to actually put the mask upside down and telling me that it was the correct way. And I said, oh, it means you do not know actually that there's a nose pin on the mask you are talking about. So if there's a nose pin, tell me where is that is your nose? That is my nose. And I said, why are you talking to the other way? Is it a chin pin or a nose pin? Are you with me? But you see, the point is this. PPE is important. If we are able to go through into more details, who will have shown us how PPE will be beneficial for somebody who is riding on a motorbike. Are you with me? But rather, not for somebody that is riding in a vehicle, in a motor car. Because somebody that is riding a motorcycle or a bicycle will need the crash helmet, would need to put on the rider's suit, and then we need to put on the hand gloves, the rubber gloves, isn't it? With the padded points, the knee pads, isn't it? But if, for example, just 1 minute, please, 1 minute, I'll ask them your question or comment. So if that is the case, therefore, you find out that for the person who is the Okada rider, okay, motorbiker, PPE is very good for him, but it's protecting only himself. And that is the answer to the question I asked before. I just wanted to juggle our faculty. He's protecting only himself. If he's protecting himself only, then how much are we talking about the whole of the laboratory environment? That's why I asked that question about PPE. So PPE is good. The other thing is, we have done drills for PPE for the doffing and donning of PPEs. And we found out that many people, actually, even though we do it in our labs every day, we don't actually know how to doff and don, depending on the PPE. So donning and doffing of PPE is therefore not just about putting on mask and removing the mask. Many even don't know how to doff the mask. Some people will pull it out from here instead of just pulling from. You know it more than me. Are you with me? So these are the various mitigation control measures. All what we have coming after that are exercises and explanations concerning the various mitigation controls which we have mentioned. And this is about the advantages and disadvantages. Just a moment before the question comes. Okay, then we can talk about this and ask the controls. Just so we are picking up the rest of the handling.
The last time I attended the management training, I at the point I was wondering as to why the number three is not number one. You know, because I was mistaking top management's commitment with their administrative control.
Okay. So, now you understand better. Thank you very much.
Because as we're talking,
yes,
something was approaching. But I think that's
Okay.
The example you gave about the mentor is very possible. So in the Bible, they use the engineering
computer. Yeah.
The
exactly.
In the Bible case, you know, what does Mark work with? There's a limit to what you can achieve.
Exactly.
So you said, because most times, I think it's supposed to be one person. But here, we don't take two people.
And that's the one you see. In Nigeria, they say, oh, on the back.
Something happened with the company. So we know, I don't know why it's an African thing, but you see, we end up, we look at that arrow, this point here, but we miss that, as you look up down,
Yes, that's
better. But in Nigeria, we spend more money on PPE.
On PPE.
And the other ones, we spend a lot of money on PPE, billions, and neglected the ones. In fact, the question of control was very difficult, because if I look at the budget, it was tiny, compared to what they spent on PPE.
You know the reason, sir? You know the reason, sir?
Yeah, no, I know.
And some of us there are also guilty of it.
Exactly.
We are trying to judge our responsibilities. Explain away our inadequacies using the reverse of this arrow. That is just what we have. But I'm doing.
I was focusing on administrative controls, applications and procedures. And I was thinking, are we focusing
more on the policy? Well, you can see it, if you don't mind, you can see it. Please.
Are we focusing more on the policy? What we are talking about administrative controls. Or, and then what we are looking at practice and procedure, are we focusing more on the SOPs? Then, that's first of all. Two, why did we separate the two? I think administrative controls, practice and procedures, they seem to be similar.
Okay, that's before we come over to you. Is it related to this?
Yes,
okay, if it's related, then we can check
it. This hierarchy of controllers is there. It also depends on the facility where you are working. And at the beginning, it depends on what you have in place. In some facilities, you will not have anything to pass. The only personal PPE that you are going to use. So it depends on what you have in place and the facility where you have.
Thank you very much. That answers part of the concern. Because, sorry, bro.
I just wanted to ask something else.
Okay, please go.
All right, still on the use of PPE. For instance, this question was well. Some persons do not know how to wear. If you go to the street, they put it below the nose. And what they are done here,
exactly.
They will tell you they are wearing PPE and they don't they don't know how to wear. So I get pissed off when I see people go to the supermarket, they put it behind the street and they are moving.
Exactly.
That's not they're protecting. It's also quite the nose.
Yeah.
So I just want to add that one.
No, thank you very much. It's a very, very smart issue. I actually don't get upset much when I see such people. I get embarrassed. And the reason is I get embarrassed for our country. Anything you are going to use has instructions that come with it. Because we are in panic mode, consistent panic mode about COVID-19, all we needed to do was grab it and wear it. Just like Prof said, in fact, somebody has told me before in this Lagos that they just said we should put it on until we are wearing it. That anytime I'm putting on the clothes, that it is the blue that is blue. And if I have to wear it, that it is the white that is inside that is better, I turn it inside out. And that if it is the black, in fact, that one is the most fashionable. In other words, some people have actually turned inside out and upside down the purpose of wearing the mask. So they therefore care less whether they wear it correctly or not. And that is where we have a duty to keep on correcting people, teaching people, talking about it. You understand? We have a duty to do that. Thank you, bro. So just before I go to another person, Madam Joe still asks a question, which I think has not been addressed. Even though our brother, Dr. Okunade, actually mentioned that, the truth is that this, broadly speaking, is the situation in general terms. Are you with me? In your risk assessment strategy, what Madam Josephine is working with in terms of the cost setting or the pathogen might be different from what Professor Wachuku is working with. The agent is a primary consideration when you are going through your risk assessment strategy. It's a primary consideration, and there are many other things that you need to consider. And there are peculiarities with each process or with each facility. Are you with me? So because of that, therefore, there is a possibility that when you consider, these hierarchies change. Okay? Now, as to the issue of administrative control should be first, it also depends on the operation of your management. Are you with me? It depends, we are not able to play a video of a risk mitigation strategy where a pathogen was brought in form of a child substance that came into a facility. Okay? So, of course, when he entered, the management had to take a decision at a certain time that we must shut down the system for it to report. That was something that the management had to do. No other person would have, or no other level of administration could do that. Are you with me? In such a situation, the administrative controls become paramount, becomes the most effective to address a situation like that. So that is also about that. Then, clearly, administrative control is different from practices and procedures. In fact, it is at the level of management that the practices and procedures are approved after it has been generated from the immediate working levels where they have gone. Are you with me? So there are two different levels completely. Professor.
In the university where I work, a car was stolen at the car park. And then they asked the owner whether he had any of the devices, came on, and that car wouldn't see. And what the university did was introduce tally, the use of tally as a case. Mm-hmm. So I see that as administrative control.
It is.
So to mitigate that, to
exactly.
So up to now, you can't drive in an app without the tally.
Exactly. Absolutely in order. Thank you, Paul.
Policy level.
Exactly. Policy level and overriding decision. Yeah, on issues. That is, okay, that's all. Bro.
Sometimes, like, because of my algorithm, I don't know that I'm that this pathogen can also be seen as a pathogen. Because when I listen to our lectures, I just think that we lost the move out of this pathogen that are capable of causing disease. The other pathogen that will not just be microbial. Like we can discuss virus, yes. We can discuss virus accountants because there are procedures that they do that can affect their system. But coming down to one of the things we are discussing about PPE, the specific controls. You know, in this working now, the people were asked. Why is it that we start from the down? And of course, what was the answer? If you start from the doubt, you benefit the more. That application in politics,
of course,
that application to a lot of things. because, like when the COVID came. We know before we started to discuss it, why is like in Nigeria or in our side? If we're talking about COVID, because COVID gave and everybody saw COVID as one instrument that people use to make quick money. People use it to make so much money. So now they are talking another way. The question is, and the politicians now need to make more money. So for the ordinary man, who have the money to make? The people of measures. Now, we talk about people are more important. Their business policy is that if you want to enter a factory, somebody must carry this. It is not that the person must get it properly. Whether you are putting like this, we don't know what you are doing. The other thing is that you are found to pay what they call a nose pass. So there is no top-down policy or method on how it should be won. The product is just carry it. So the moment you are carrying it, it's a requirement. So I think part of the problem we have in our kind of where this is about the it will require a lot of teaching, a lot of training,
implementation,
because our own kind of system, the system where everything, whether it is not that can cause death, the Nigerian things that can cause death, can this thing be manipulated to generate benefit?
Exactly.
And the benefit is financial, not benefit that can be managed to protect people. No. So the movement that corruption comes in, the people are involved in the policy goes to that area.
I agree with you 100%. But I have an announcement. First of all, that announcement is that one of the sub-teams of the conference that happened in November is about updates on COVID-19 pandemic. Because there are a lot to be discussed about COVID-19. Another item to discuss there is entrepreneurial activities related to COVID-19. That is to let you know that the issue of COVID-19 has actually gone beyond isolation. That's just the truth. Now, that's related to COVID-19. So you cannot default it on what you have said. The other thing I want to add to you, as comical as my son, as a statement of fact, when some states, such as River State, notice that Lagos collected 10 billion naira from the federal government for fight against COVID-19. Even though they were saying initially we have two, we have 10. They don't. Because that's not the way also of claiming their own. But unfortunately, after they wanted to claim their own 10 billion, Mr. Blair said, no, everything you need, list them out, we supply that. You understand? So there's more than COVID-19 than what they are talking about here.
I want to add that the people that we are using now in this island, I'll tell you what.
Okay.
Mitigation measures that have interfered with the freedom and comfort of humans. I don't know if it's successful in the case of community. That is why you find that diseases that those mitigation measures affect human comfort. They are still with us today. Like most STDs, for example, still happen. Now, what am I saying is the most disable PPE we use for community is the face mask.
Even among professionals, they are supposed to use your face mask one at a time and be careful about donning and doffing.
Even me speaking here, it's difficult to go for it. Because as I was giving this lecture, you see your face mask. After a while, you want to scratch your face, you want to spill your face. Somehow, you feel going to touch the surface. Once you touch this surface, what can the effect of this infection for that? It's useless. So you go to your pocket, then you hold your phone with it. Then you take it and be back on the phone. So, end of the day, thank you, I got that most people who caught the COVID-19 wore mask at work. Hand sanitizer. Now, how many times you are consciously touch this exposed part of your face and sanitizer? This human nature reflects up. It is extremely difficult. You can do it for a pandemic, maybe something for a week or two, but it becomes part of you. It is extremely difficult to do it to person.
Now, I'm happy that you got my message.
Yeah,
when I brought this. What we actually are trying to do, which I know you also know very well, but you need to also interpret it, is that it is not just one method that fits it. It's an integration of various methods. Are you with me? It is true that many people will now remember to immediately use the hand sanitizer. But what I'm saying is that if many people can use the hand wash station, use the sanitizer, use the nose mask, and use it well, and then we train ourselves to be conscious not to touch the face of the nose mask after wearing it, and also learn not to repeat the use of the same mask they are using. Are you with me? After you say beyond the day, in the training we had in Nasarawa, after every lunch, to replace. Oh, yes, somebody's paying the bill. Somebody even confirmed to me that the one he also told me that they also had a deal. Let us go through performance. All right. This is the introduction to performance. What performance is all about in a nutshell is you want to have it from time to time. Is the system running the way you have planned it to work? If it is not running the way you have planned it to work, then you need to take more mitigation measures into use. So, because, you know, at the onset of using a particular, of going through a particular process, everything appears that it is perfect. But in the process of time, and as you advance in taking the procedural steps, you begin to notice certain flaws, or certain equipment are no longer working efficiently as at when it started to be in use. That is when you will need to either change, bring in another one, or service the one that you are already using. In some cases, when there are holes that have been punctured in the different processing lines, there might be need to double up so that as much as possible you cover those holes. That is all what performance is about. Sometimes it might involve the change of personnel because the personnel might be compromised. Sometimes it might be about the engineering facilities. Are you with me? And sometimes it might be policy decisions that have been flawed because they have not been observed. This is all what performance is about. We just want to call your attention to it because it's a critical aspect of the risk assessment strategy. It was the last aspect that Dr. Easter mentioned, and it is so important. The fact that it is the last one mentioned does not mean that it is the least important. It is as a matter of fact, it is as important as the two other aspects of the AMP. It only happens to be the third one that is mentioned all the time. So that is where the issue of performance takes us. And I will just want to show us this, that there is no mitigation that is perfect. It can only be perfect perhaps at the onset. Once you go on to implement one mitigation measure, there are holes and weaknesses that pops up. Just like you look at this graph. Has everything changed? I'll go back to the first one. Situation involving hazard or threat is what you have there. And then you have the consequence on the other side. The mitigation measure is the block. Right. And then here you are. Has there been a change in situation? Yes, because here you now have a tripling of the mitigation block. Now, go to this first one. And you see, look at the consequence. All right. Now, here, look at the consequence again. No, the point is this. If the consequence still remains where it is, then those mitigation measures are still failing.
That's what that
means. Exactly.
The size of the consequence.
Sorry?
The
size of the consequence. No, it's not even the question.
Look at this.
It is not a matter of design. It is that there are holes that are punctured that needed to be mitigated.
When you triple it,
no, you see, it can reduce the likelihood.
Yes.
It might not have totally stopped it, but has reduced the likelihood because it takes more effort for the hazard to continue to pass. That is just it. Yes, sir. This is what we know. This will make us understand better. Just 1 minute, though. Now, you need to find out what are the goals that have been created in the system. This is what performance is about. How big are the goals? Okay? And have they grown larger over time? Are there new goals that are forming? Are you with me? Over the time? And is the risk management system working as intended? So if it's not working as intended, then please those mitigation measures are not effective.
Okay, sorry. So this
is
a very interesting concept.
Yeah.
Just there's something new now that I will take it back to my own notion. I come from the mission.
Yeah.
So we have a similar concept like this. But we should not explain hazards and then we use the Swiss cheese. So this is different.
Yeah.
The same thing, but different. You know, we don't think that rules can get bigger. We now see that. Because the concept is that all you need to do is to prevent.
Once
you
misalign
the goals,
yeah.
All you have to do is just get
aligned.
If
all
the goals are
aligned, yes, when they are aligned,
then you
think
we still pass through.
Exactly.
Just one singular factor of
instruction. Yeah.
Then you
accept
the body. We don't talk about the goals getting bigger.
Exactly.
Yes, they can get bigger.
Okay, now let me share this with you. That is the time when you are from the application emotion. 2009 to 2010, I was the technical consultant on the wildlife hazard analysis for FAN, Lagos Port, Aminu Kano, and Abuja Airports. The issue was that there were a lot of air crashes due to weather strikes. Now, the point is that the air crashes continued to increase because there was a certain mitigation measure that was supposed to be applied that was not applied. So the animals within the presence of those airports continued to increase, and they continued to come around the tarmac and the hangar of the aircraft. So when they switch on the engine, the animals get sucked in and they damage the engine. When the pilot is unaware and it takes off, the takeoff and the landing, those are the critical aspects of the flight. The engine is already damaged. If the pilot cannot make a quick return, the aircraft is likely to crash. You understand? So now when we went in there and we carried out the assessment and we now suggested mitigation that some of the ones that have not been done, but those that have been done have actually drastically reduced the air crashes due to wildlife activities. I would be able to come up with this because of what you mentioned, that when these mitigation measures continue to develop and they are not, the mitigation is either not doubled or not renewed. You understand? The loss continues to get bigger. And that is what we have had in the case of the crashes leading to loss of lives, loss of a lot of money, and of course, loss of confidence on Nigeria. In fact, ICAO actually plays an embargo on the Nigerian airspace because of much of that. That's why they said the aircraft will be landed in Ghana.
Thank you. Yeah, okay, another contribution, just as I said earlier, that the whole idea of this training is not just a confined to laboratory setting. It's a holistic thing. You were talking about the common policy and not the rest of them. Now, I also want to think, you know, sometimes, like we're the active nation, we're not proud of something to say that. But,
go ahead, sir.
Okay. When there's a fire break, in any building, anywhere,
yeah.
The fire service unit that's supposed to have water, not to have emergency, they say no water, no noise, nothing. How do you figure out this? See the problem there?
It is a serious
now, in the laboratory, too, you're talking about producing good quality results. No equipment, not only talk about service unit. No equipment at all to start with. If you have the personnel, but no equipment, what do we do? This is from the field ratio. And it can go widening. Bigger holes, like that.
Yes, the holes continue to get
bigger. Yeah.
You are very correct. I agree with you. Yeah. So,
let me say something.
Yes.
You said you ask the question of what do we do? Actually, you can only do what you can do. Certain things are beyond us. They're just for purposes of gathering here and also being someone that has been in some level of administration, you know, high level too. Advocacy is very important. And when you're going for advocacy, a former minister in this country once told us, when he was a minister, the things he didn't know, he would run to the president, oh, my people are dying, this and that. But when he came out, he now realized that when you're going for advocacy, go with data. Have information that you will use to justify whatever you're asking for. So when things are going wrong, you know, and you know for this safety issues that we're talking about, do a small write-up with data to justify that if these things are not done over time, in the interim, this is where we are. These are the likelihood of so and so happening if these things are not done within a specified time. Put it in writing. Don't do advocacy, sit down, discuss it. When you're going, go with a hard copy of what everything you're going to say, write it down. When you're leaving, give a copy.
Okay.
That copy will speak for you. When that catastrophe eventually happens, they will remember that you came to the talking about.
Thank you very much, man. The thing I need to add to that is that one of the critical components of every of our training is for you to get back to base and step up. Now, in stepping down, we will expect that your focus should be very relevant to the immediate facility and extending to other facilities that are contingent to your activities. When you do this, it strikes the management very well. Then later, when we have opportunity of listening to this kind of event that we are holding, it now makes a more lasting impression and they are bound to think something. In our university some time ago, fire broke out in the library. Fire breaking out in the library is one of the worst fires. Mm-hmm. Are you with me?
Yes.
Up to today, I don't know how we managed to escape the library being completely consumed in the fire. But our experience was that there was no fire station. We did not call upon the Lagos. None of them responded. I'm telling you, the vice chancellor had to escalate to the governor. But at the time, the last one, the one that came as a last-ditch effort, the fire had already been controlled by our facility manager. So, Prof, we are very, very correct. At the University of Jos, 3 years ago, a three-story building of library completely burnt down by fire. No response from any fire stations. They are still struggling to put the library back till today. So your observation is very correct. Now there is one thing about performance. Performance is measurable. If you look at it very well, you will see that the hole that has been created in the mitigation measure are affecting productivity. Prof mentioned something about not having what we need to work with and the expected result. The management is expecting output, but the output cannot come the way it should come because there are already holes in the mitigation measure. And you can determine that by way of measuring what is supposed to come out and what are we getting. Now there are obstacles to measuring this performance, and the obstacles have been displayed on the screen for about 10 minutes now. These are the obstacles. Physically, you should be able to measure the thing. If you are not able to measure it, sorry, it should be reliable. Reliability is a problem. Because you may not be able to take the date of measuring it as detailed as it ought to be. We can go on and on because of our time. So, well, the steps that are involved in evaluating performance, we can summarize in this. Define the goal. What exactly do you want to achieve? What are the indicators of performance? And then, are you collecting data? You must collect data. Then, you must act on the findings, just like we have pointed out in our discussion. We must act on that, and I add what Dr. Ogo said. It is time now, time sensitive. Because the more you leave it to linger on, then the more the whole will continue to get wider. After you have acted, you must still go back and review. Review those indicators as much as possible to know whether the performance is still a top gear or not, whether the mitigations are still okay as they're supposed to be. So after that, the only thing you need to do now is to go and take lunch.
Okay. So, you have a